Why live a normal life when you could be living the abundant life? Welcome to the Abundant Life Program with Ashley and Carly Terades.
Hello and welcome to Abundant Life. We're so glad you're joining us today. We've got a great program for you. We're excited, praise God. We're talking about the key to your success. The key to your success, praise God.
So that sounds exciting.
It does, doesn't it?
You've got me intrigued now.
We're talking about thankfulness.
Oh.
Did you know your thankfulness can make so much difference? It's amazing. Mm. When we're thankful, and we're going to take you through some things here that's going to bless you. Our key scripture is 1 Thessalonians 5:16, 17, and 18. So if you've got your Bibles, you can turn there with us. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through to 18. Verse 16, some of the shortest verses you'll find in the Bible here. I think after Jesus wept, this is the shortest verse. Rejoice always. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 says, rejoice always. And then 17 says, pray without ceasing. And then 18 says, in everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. This is the will of God for you. Now, we have a lot of people come to us and say, how do I know God's will for my life? I would love to know God's will for my life. And you know, that's a good desire. You know, we want to know God's will for our life so we can walk in it and we can walk in the blessing. We can walk in everything God has for us. But I'm telling you, this right here is a great starting place to find God's will. It says right here, this is God's will in Christ Jesus for you. This is God's will for you. When we start living this way, when we start giving thanks, when we start praying without ceasing and giving thanks, rejoicing always, that's God's will for us. That's going to, when we do those things, we're going to find God's will a lot easier to come by.
Amen. Amen. And you know, isn't it powerful that sometimes when you're going through a trial, you're going through a challenge, it's like the least amount of time that you really feel like giving thanks.
It really is.
That's the time when you need to.
I found personally the times when I've least felt like rejoicing and giving thanks in all things, just like it says here, when I've least felt like it, has been the most important times for me to do it. So, you know, when everything's going well with you, when you're having a good day and everything's working out, it's easy to be thankful. But I'm telling you, when the devil comes at you with a challenge, or when you're having a challenge in your flesh,
a flesh flash.
If you have it, if your flesh is rising up against you, maybe you've got relational issues, you know, you've got relationship issues, whatever it is, that's the most important time to rejoice. Go and rejoice. You know, Philippians 4:4 talks about rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. That's the most important time for us to rejoice. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, I'm just being honest with you, I've had to do this through gritted teeth. I've had times in my life where everything seems to be going wrong, and I've had to almost, you know, gritted teeth, go, Lord, I thank you, and I start rejoicing, and I start forcing myself. You know, David says this time and time again in the Psalms. He says, you know, rejoice in the Lord. You know, he tells his soul, Psalm 103. He says, you know what? Bless the Lord, O my soul. He tells himself to bless the Lord. Sometimes we can tell ourselves, you know what? Rejoice in the Lord. Give thanks, even when we least feel like it. And when we do that, when we least feel like it, it's the most powerful times. I'm telling you, when you're doing that, that takes faith.
It does.
It really takes faith to do that.
You mentioned David says, bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me.
Amen.
It's almost like David was giving himself a pep talk.
Yep, he was telling himself.
He was coaching himself.
He was telling himself. And that's actually one of the stories we're going to cover today about David. You know, we'll find this story in 1 Samuel chapter 30. And this is a story. We won't go into the whole story for lack of time. But what I want to tell you about this story, David has gone out. He's come back to Ziklag and he's got his men with him. And he's found that while he was out at battle, people have come in and taken their wives and children hostage and burnt their town down.
That's a bad day.
This is a bad day. So David has come back. He's been on the battlefield. He's come back home.
He just wants a hot shower and a meal and go to bed, right?
He's come back home and he finds his town is burning down. Literally, their houses are burning down. And worse than that, their wives and their children have been taken hostage. Mm. They've been kidnapped and taken away. They don't know if they're dead or alive. This is a bad situation, and it gets worse. It gets even worse. Not only do they take David's wives and children, the men's wives and children away, but also he turns to his faithful men, you know, his band of brothers, if you like, his band of men, and they talk about stoning David. They're so distressed.
They turned against him.
They're so distressed, right. They're so distressed that their whole lives have been taken away from them. They turned to David and it says that they thought of stoning him and they were going to try and kill David. So David's lost his family. He's lost his possessions, and now he's lost the very people that he was fighting with, mm-hmm. his brothers, if you like. Now, that is a bad day. That's a time to be discouraged, if ever there was one. David was not having a good day, and it said he wept until he could weep no more. You know what happened? It says in 1 Samuel chapter 30, you know what? He encouraged himself in the Lord. He encouraged himself in the Lord. You know what? David made a decision to encourage himself in the Lord.
How do you encourage yourself in the Lord?
Good question, Carly. I'm glad you asked.
I figured you might have the answer.
I'm glad you asked. You know what we're looking at today? This is one of the most powerful ways you can encourage yourself in the Lord. Start rejoicing. The first thing is rejoice. Look back on what the Lord's done for you. Mm. Doesn't matter how bad your circumstances, there's always something you can rejoice about. Rejoice is like rehearsing a past joicing, past joy.
Rehearse your past victories.
That's what the word means. Yeah, yeah. Rehearse your past joy. So you can always find something to be joyful for. And you know what? Joy is different from happiness. It's not just about being happy all the time. If you went through what David went through, I'm sure you wouldn't be happy. And David certainly wasn't happy here. But you know what? He was able to rejoice. He was able to encourage himself in the Lord because he was able to look back and think, you know what? All the times when God had delivered him, he was able to give thanks to God. And we can always find things to be thankful for. Mm-hmm. And you might be watching or listening today and thinking, actually, you don't know my circumstances. There's nothing for me to give thanks for. You know, thank God for salvation. Thank God for Jesus. Thank God that you're still breathing. You know, thank God for whatever you can thank God for. There's always things you can thank God for. And when you change your focus from the situation, from the circumstance, however bad that is, and turn it on to what you can be thankful for and start rejoicing in the Lord, it's amazing how your focus will change and you start magnifying the Lord. You start magnifying who He is in your life and your problem starts to get smaller, starts to diminish.
Absolutely. I remember one time we were living in the farmhouse in England. Mm-hmm. You remember back then? And we had, about 10, actually used to buy and sell vehicles, cars. And that's how we made our living and paid our bills and paid our Bible college tuition and fed our kids. And one day we had like 10 cars sitting out in the yard there. And like the money in the bank was getting really low. And I know it's bad when Ashley tells me not to go to the grocery store.
Oh, she'd go shopping and I'd say,
it was feast or famine.
Just buy the essentials. I'd be like, just buy the essentials
milk
today. Because we was going through Bible college. And then that was the way that we was able to, you know, support ourselves through Bible college is I was trading cars on the weekends and things like that.
But we were stock heavy and cash poor, I guess you could say.
Yep.
And I was just in the kitchen there and washing up. And I was kind of getting to griping and complaining and belly aching to the Lord. Let me know how that goes for you, because it never ends up very well for me, right? And in the end, I'm like, Lord, what is the deal with this? We are a Bible college, for goodness sake. We are following the will of God for our lives. We have sacrificed to be here. We moved to be here. We're in this house. We're just trying to scrape by. What is it? Why can't these cars just sell so we just need to eat? And I mean, I'd gotten to the end of myself. It was a bad day. I was having a fit of carnality, right? And standing there doing the washing up, and the Lord said, you know what the problem is, Carlie? And I'm like, no, please tell me. He says, you've forgotten you're blessed. And I'm like,
that's good.
Wow. Man, it just kind of hit me. It was like one of those aha moments. I'm like, you're right, Lord. I've forgotten I'm blessed. In other words, I'd forgotten to be thankful. I'd forgotten to start. I'd gotten my mind off all of the good things that were going on in our life. Mm. The fact that we had a house, that I had a family, that we had 10 cars sitting out in the yard there. I'd forgotten about the provision of God and the leading of Him in my life and the gift of the Spirit that He'd put in. I'd forgotten to start thanking God for all the good things that were going on, and my mind was only focused on what was going wrong. And because of that, I think it was hindering our prosperity. I think it was having physical consequences. And so when the Lord said, you know what, Carly, you have forgotten you're blessed. Man, it just kind of went off like a rocket on the inside of me. I'm like, you're right, God, I repent. And I started getting into thanking Him. Thank you, Lord, for every good thing that you've put on the inside of me in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for my house and the cars. And I realized the scripture came back to my remembrance. In Deuteronomy, it says that the flocks of your field are blessed.
Amen.
Right? And everything that you touch prospers. Man, I'm like, I don't have flocks out there, but I have cars, right? So I swung open the door and I went marching out there and I started laying hands on all the cars and blessing the cars.
Did you wash them while you laid hands
on
them?
No, I didn't.
Okay.
No, because I'm not that kind. No. So So I should have taken the dishcloth with me. Yeah, I guess, wash it, right? I should have done. But I said, red car, you're blessed. Blue car, you're blessed. Green car, you're blessed.
You didn't go for like make or model, you just went for the colours.
It's not important. It's not important. It's just what
I said, Carly, what car did they have? And she says, a red one.
Red one.
I said, okay.
So anyway, the point of the story is, I started thanking God for what we had. Rather than seeing those things as being an obstacle, mm-hmm. I started thanking God for where we was at. And I'm like, Lord, I thank you. We only need one buyer for every car. We don't need 10 people to come and look at the cars. But Lord, I thank you, Lord, that any person that comes in our yard is going to be leaving with a car. And I don't know, something changed, didn't it?
It really did.
Do you remember
what
happened after that? It was supernatural.
After weeks of not having any buyers, the next thing I know, the phone's ringing, people are coming around, and literally every person that came around was buying cars. In fact, one person came around and left and didn't buy a car, and Carly was totally surprised. I was surprised too, because the previous 5 or 6 people, literally one person came, they bought a car. The next person came, they bought a car. So this person came and they went and they didn't buy a car. And then about an hour later, they called back and said, we've changed our mind. We're coming to buy it.
We knew you would.
We're coming to buy it. So it was amazing how it changed. And that's not a coincidence. And this has happened to me in all different areas. This happened in business. This has happened in relationships. This has happened in all different areas. When you're thankful, it impacts the circumstance. Mm-hmm. When you give thanks, it's like you're inviting God into the situation. And it impacts the circumstance. So I'm telling you, give thanks. David here in 1 Samuel chapter 30, after he wept till he couldn't weep anymore, he encouraged himself in the Lord. He gave thanks. Mm-hmm. And you know what? He got up and he got his men together. So he restored those relationships. He got his men together and they went out and they recovered all. Mm-hmm. They got their wives back. They got their children back and they recovered all. Praise God. So when you give thanks in a situation, when you rejoice, always, it affects the circumstance. And these are some of the things we're looking at today is how your thankfulness can change things. Your thankfulness can change your circumstance. And you might be saying, well, actually, you don't understand. Try it. I'm telling you, when you try it, it's amazing how it works. This has happened to me so many times, you can't convince me otherwise. When you give thanks in situations, it's like you're inviting God in and it changes the circumstance. So I've got here some notes. I've got here that the first thing that thankfulness does is it changes the circumstances. It actually makes it creates breakthrough. It changes the circumstance. A great example of this is in Acts 16:25. You know, there was Paul and Silas were in prison, and I'm gonna look this up for you so we can read this out. This is Acts 16 and verse 25. And what happened here was Paul and Silas were thrown into prison. And, you know, again, they'd had a bad day, a little bit like David, right? They'd had a bad day. They'd been beaten. They'd been put into prison, chained against the prison walls. And you know what happened? They started rejoicing. They started giving thanks.
Those prisons, they were not like, you know, vacation camps, right? They didn't have like TV and an exercise yard and three meals a day.
They didn't have TV, not because they weren't in prison, because it was 2,000 years ago.
But I mean, you think the prisons of today are bad? I mean, this was almost like an open sewer.
It was. It was down in the dungeons.
There was nothing in the natural to be thankful for in the moment.
Yeah. So yeah. So it was a bad. It was a bad situation. It wasn't. It was. It really was. And you know, they got. It says in verse 25 of Acts 16. He said, "But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to him. They started worshiping God." Imagine this. Paul and Silas were in prison. They don't know what happens. They haven't got Acts, the book of Acts, so they can read and think, don't worry, Silas, it's going to turn out okay.
They hadn't read the end of the book.
We get out of here. They didn't know the end of this. All they knew was they were beaten and they were put in prison for something they didn't do. And guess what? They started rejoicing. At midnight, they started rejoicing, started thanking God so loud that the other prisoners could hear them. And guess what happened? Suddenly, a great earthquake, verse 26. The foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosed. Isn't that amazing? Them giving thanks changed the situation. You can't tell me that didn't make a difference. When they started giving thanks, the situation changed, praise God. So when we give thanks, we change the situation. We allow breakthrough to happen. And you know, we're on the opposite end of this, you know, this is no condemnation. I'm just saying I have to watch this myself. When we start moaning about things, when we start reporting how bad everything is, oh, this doesn't work, that's not working, I don't like this, this isn't working out. It's like the opposite. We start going down and we prevent God's blessing in certain areas.
You know,
ungratefulness is as dangerous as thankfulness is powerful.
It's like cursing your situation.
It really is.
In Proverbs, it says that life and death are in the power of the tongue. I think when we're thankful, it's like we are speaking life into the situation.
Amen.
But when we get to belly aching and griping and complaining, we're speaking death into the situation. At that same mouth, blessings and curses come, mm-hmm. right? And it's up to us. We're the variable, not the circumstances, but we're the variable. We can decide whether we're going to bless our situation and speak life into it through thankfulness, or whether we're just going to go ahead, swing the door wide open and invite the enemy. You might as well have just invite the enemy in with our words by speaking death and destruction and ungratefulness into the situation.
Yep. Yep, it's huge.
We can change the climate just with our words.
It's huge. It really is. So challenge yourself. Be thinking about, you know, when you're moaning about something, can't you find something good to give thanks for instead of moaning about something? You know, in verse 18 of 1 Thessalonians 5, where we started, 1 Thessalonians 5:18, it says, in everything give thanks. Mm. That doesn't mean you give thanks for everything. You know what? Some things happen to us are bad things. They're not right. You know, it's not fair. Sometimes things happen to us because, you know, it's the devil, the enemy out there. Or sometimes people come against us. Sometimes circumstances can come against us. And sometimes we go through things that just, this is not fair. We shouldn't go through these things. But you know what? We can still give thanks even in those situations. So even in the darkest situation, you know, just like Paul and Silas were chained to a prison wall, they gave thanks. Just like David, you know, lost his wife and his kids and saw his village burn down, he was still able to give thanks. You can give thanks in any situation. You can
That's
find
really
a situation
key.
To give thanks in. And I was thinking one time we was facing a terrible time in our lives, and it's a long story, but we was going into something. We didn't know how it was going to turn out. And it was pretty serious. It was a lawsuit against us. And you know what? On the way to the court, we was rejoicing. Do you mm-hmm. remember? And we didn't know how this was going. This could be turn out terrible. And we was on the way to the courtroom, mm-hmm. and we could have lost everything that day, literally. But we was rejoicing. We started thanking God to the point where we started getting a praise party on.
And
we were
rejoicing.
We were dancing. We were rejoicing in God, even though we was going into something where literally we could have lost everything in the natural. But we started rejoicing and started thanking God. And we got to the point where whatever happens, we're giving thanks and we're going to worship mm-hmm. God, praise God. So this is a position of strength if you can rejoice through any situation.
I know there are going to be some people watching and thinking, well, it's you know, it's easy for you to say, but I'm going through this and, you know, my body hurts and, you know, my finances are non-existent and everybody hates me and the world against me. Or maybe you're incarcerated. Maybe you're mm-hmm. in a prison cell. You've got a physical prison around you. And they're thinking, you don't understand my situation. How can I just start rejoicing? Well, that's the point. You just start.
Yep, you choose to.
It's a choice.
And it takes faith. It's a choice and it takes faith because everything in you, your flesh and your soul are going to be like, don't do it. But your spirit's always rejoicing. So it takes a choice. Like, I'm going to choose to rejoice. And I'm going to choose some practical things you can do. I'm getting ahead of myself, but I'll tell you anyway. Some of the things I do, you know, I have a journal and I write things down I'm thankful for. I write things down and say,
like,
thank you for this. Like a testament. I write things down I'm mm-hmm. thankful for. And sometimes I reread those things. I look at those and I think, yeah, all these things I've got to be thankful for. And I remind myself, as I'm driving along, I remind myself of things to be thankful for. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've had cars that aren't great to drive. You know, they've got these little, I call them character traits. They're little flaws in them and things with their older cars with higher mileage. And I start thinking, instead of moaning, oh, my car's got high mileage and I don't like my car. It doesn't, you know, the heater isn't great and it hasn't got a, whatever, an MP3 player and all these things. Start moaning about it. How about start giving thanks and say, God, I thank you that I've got a car. 90% of the world would love to have a car, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, you know what, give thanks for what you can give thanks for. Start being thankful for God and start rehearsing your victories. Start rejoicing in those things. It's powerful when we do that. It really does. It's amazing how it can change the circumstances.
Amen.
So I challenge you, start doing that. Start putting thankfulness in your daily routine. Start thanking God for it because it will give you breakthrough. It will change the circumstance. I've got here even, it creates increase. When we are thankful, mm-hmm. it creates increase in our lives. Mm-hmm. You know, a great example of this is the feeding of the 5,000.
This is a good example.
When Jesus fed the 5,000, you know, this is a great story that most of us know, and you've probably read in Sunday school and things like that. But there's a great point here with the feeding of the 5,000. I'm looking at Matthew 15, and the story is Matthew 15, verses 14 through 19. But you know, with the feeding of the 5,000, that something very critical happened. And sometimes you read over it. So if you've got your Bibles, turn this. Matthew 15, And as you know in the story, that Jesus has been teaching all day, the people haven't eaten, and you know, there's a bit of a crisis, there's a bit of a situation here. The crowd are hungry, there's nowhere to buy food, they haven't got enough money to buy food. The disciples come to Jesus saying, what are we going to do? These people need to eat. Mm-hmm. And what happens is before you know it, that they find Jesus says, what have we got? And they come together and they say, you know, we've got a few loaves and a few fish.
That's it, basically. Yeah?
A few loaves and a few fish. Mm-hmm. Let me see if I can get the right verse here.
In verse 34 it says, and Jesus said to them, how many loaves do you have? Mm-hmm. And they said, seven and a few fish. So he commanded the multitude to sit down on the ground. He took the seven loaves and the fish and he gave thanks.
Isn't that powerful? Mm. He gave thanks. So imagine this. He had such a need. I mean, let's look at this in the natural, okay? 5,000 men, you know, they said also women and children. So who knows? Could have been 10,000, 15,000 people, but let's just say 5,000 men, and he's got a few loaves and a few fish, enough to feed one person.
That's worse than bringing, like, you know, one little roll to a tailgating party.
That's right.
With hungry teenagers.
No, it's a lot worse than that. We're talking about like, you know, yeah, a football stadium, and someone walks in with, you know, one packet of chips or something.
I mean, that's not a drop in the ocean.
No, this is like having a $200,000 debt and someone giving you $20. I mean, this is an extreme need. But guess what Jesus does? He takes those loaves and fish. In one of the translations, it says, what are so few among so many? And he says, you know, what are so few? The disciples said, this isn't going to work. But Jesus says, no, give them to me. He takes those loaves and fish and he gives thanks for them.
Mm. So he blesses what exactly. he has rather than cursing the lack.
That's good, Carlie. That's exactly right. So he's blessing what he has. He's giving thanks for what he has. And he's looking up and he's saying, thank you, Father, for these loaves and fish. You know, he's thanking for the seed. He's thanking God for the seed. See, and it says, looking. You know, Jesus looked beyond the natural. And he saw, you know what, these loaves and fish, these are seeds, and this can actually produce something, you know, a harvest. This could produce far more than what we just see here in the natural. So he was looking into the spiritual realm, and he could see that, you know what, these few loaves and fish could actually be, in God's hands, could actually be creating abundance. But the key thing is he gave thanks for them.
Yeah.
Now, how many times have you been in this situation, just say financial situation, and you have a small amount of finances, and we curse our seed, we say, this isn't enough. This isn't enough to pay my rent or to pay my bills. Mm. This isn't enough. And we curse our seed rather than giving thanks and saying, thank you, Lord, for the money I do have. And maybe sowing that and giving thanks as we sow that.
Speaking life to the situation.
Speaking life to the situation. So Jesus gave thanks even in a situation that seemed impossible. He gave thanks for what he had. Like you said, Carly, he gave thanks for what he had rather than the moaning and cursing about what he didn't have, about the lack. And guess what happened? The increase came, praise God, and before you know it, all those people were fed. And not only were they were fed till they were full. This was the original all-you-could-eat buffet.
Wow, there you go.
They were fed till they were full, till they could eat no more. And there was 12 baskets left over of fragments that they picked up. And so there was even leftovers. They even took boxes home, you know, of leftovers.
To-go boxes.
That's how much food there was, just because Jesus was thankful for that seed. So I want to challenge you. You know what? In whatever circumstance you're going through, be thankful. That can create increase in your life. Be thankful for your job. I know sometimes people moan about, well, you don't understand my job. It doesn't pay enough. And my boss is blah, blah, blah. My co-workers is a toxic environment. How about you start thanking God for your job? Thank you, God, for my job. Thank you that I am employed. Thank you that I do have somewhere to work. What about your family? Lord, you don't understand. I have whatever, these kids or these parents or whatever it is. Start thanking God for them. Say, God, thank you for my family. Thank you for my brothers and sisters. Thank you for my kids. Thank you for my parents. What about the people in your life that, you know, my friend calls them sandpaper people?
They irritate you. They rub you the wrong way.
Try giving thanks for those people to God. Start praying for them and saying, God, thank you for these people.
You know, this is such practical wisdom, and it really will work in any situation. You can apply it to any challenge that you're going through. I had a gentleman come from ministry just the other day, actually, and he actually had a list written out in front of him of all of the things that he couldn't do because of this condition.
Wow.
I mean, there must have been a whole page, at least 20, 25 things on that page, all the things. And as he was going through and explaining them to me, he says, well, I used to be able to do this, but I can't do that anymore because of this. And I used to be able to go here, but I can't do that anymore because of this.
Wow.
And it was almost like a toxic conversation. Mm. It was hard just being around him, not I mean, it sounds unkind, but I could feel the negativity, like it was a toxic environment. And in the end, I said, listen, you want to receive healing, we got to change this attitude. You're going to find it really hard to receive with this toxicity. I think is the
toxicity,
word.
Toxicity, is that a word?
I think so.
You heard it here first, folks. There's a new word invented.
No. But I said to him, what I want you to do, I'm not going to pray for you right now. It was like a 3-day long conference. So what I want you to do is go away, and I believe that this is a God-inspired idea because I'm not that smart. But I said, go away, and I want you to write a thankful list. Everything, I want at least for every line that you've got in here of something that you can't do, I want you to write a list of you being thankful for what you can do. We need to counteract this toxic thinking that you've got going on. And so come back to me at 3 days later, at the end of the conference. You know, it's amazing. 3 days changes everything.
Amen. It really does.
I'm just saying,
really,
right?
If you've got an issue, wait 3 days.
Wait 3 days. It's subject to change. He came back at the end of the conference, and he had this list. And his countenance looked different.
Wow.
He had spent time being thankful for what he did have. Now, physically, his situation hadn't changed. But what he'd done, he'd prepared his heart to receive. And sure enough, when I prayed for him, his symptoms improved, and he received a breakthrough.
Amen.
But it was that attitude of gratitude that led him into victory.
Attitude of gratitude. Yep. I like that, Carlie. Attitude of gratitude. Mm-hmm. And your attitude determines your altitude.
Amen. You know,
but that's powerful. So thankfulness is so powerful. As we said, you know what? It can impact your circumstance. It can bring about increase. And I'm telling you, it can change things for the better. And you know what? You need to make a choice to do that. We all do.
You might start in the flesh, right?
Yeah.
But you'll end in the spirit.
Amen. That's a good point. Yeah, I challenge myself to do this. You know, there's times when I feel myself not being thankful, and I'm like, you know what? No. And I challenge myself to start being thankful and start giving thanks for everything in my life. You know, all the things that I can give thanks for, I give thanks for. And it's amazing when I do that, it changes my outlook.
Right.
And therefore, it changes the circumstance, and it creates an environment of increase, praise God, and bless Him.
So it's important to say as well, this isn't natural to your flesh.
No, it's contrary.
Right? People live generally in the place of how they feel. We're talking about living with our mindset on spiritual things.
Yeah.
Right? To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
It takes faith. It really
yeah,
does
it
take
does.
Faith.
But we
God.
Have to make our flesh do this. It's not going to happen naturally.
No,
we
have to make
to
a choice.
To be thankful.
Just like David did. Bless the Lord, yep. O my soul. You know what? We're out of time this time. We're going
to
carry on next program. But for now, we want to pray for you. And we want to thank you for joining us. Mm. And we appreciate you joining us. We'll be back real soon. But in the meantime, let me pray for you. Father God, I thank you for everyone watching and listening to this program. I thank you, Lord, every one of us has something to be thankful for. You're such a good God, Lord.
Amen.
You've done so much good for us. We've got so much to be thankful for. Thank you, Lord, for saving us. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for everything you've done for us. We love you, Lord. And we repent of not being thankful enough, Lord. We want to be thankful people. We want to be people that are thanking you all the time and rejoicing always. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for showing us this today. And we make a commitment, Lord, to thank you more often. Mm. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you,
praise
Lord.
God.
You're a good God.
He's a good God, isn't he? Amen. Well, thanks for joining us. We'll see you back real soon. Until then, go out and live the abundant life.
To order your copy of this teaching, visit our website, teredezministries.com. Download your free copy of Ashley and Carly's teaching notes at our website, teredezministries.com.
Hey, I want to tell you about Carly's confession card she wrote. It's a little card, it's prescription size, and you know, it has verses about who you are in Christ. This is powerful. I use this regularly. You put your name at the top and then you read it to yourself. It says here, I'm a party waiting to happen, 1 Peter 1:8. It says, I've been sanctified, 1 Corinthians 6:11. I'm a child of the King, adopted into His family. It goes on and on. I lack no good thing. I can do all things through Christ. You know what? This card is powerful. This will change your life. This will show you who you are in Christ. And I'm telling you, if you haven't got one of these yet, go to our website, teredezministries.com. We'd love to give one of these to you as our gift, completely free. So go to our website, teredezministries.com, and get your confession card today.
Why live a normal life when you could be living the abundant life? Join us next time for the Abundant Life program with Ashley and Carly Teredez.